somebody will put out an agent, and then somebody will trick it into not only going using these tools to look up data, and then it can take that and actually send it to the attacker. Or even worse, it can actually send the attacker its credentials, like a token or some other authorization. So then that person, they'll just use that sort of compromised authentication to go access that data directly.
MCP servers can be a great standardized way for agents to talk to each other, but they often can come with security risks. That's what we're diving deeper into in this episode of AI Explainer series. My name is Meena Ganesh, Senior Product Marketing Manager for AI at Box. I'm here with our CTO, Ben Kus, and let's get into it. Ben, let's recap a little for our viewers. What's an MCP server?
Yeah, so MCP is Model Context Protocol. It was a standard that was put forth by Anthropic, which is one of the major model vendors. And it was meant as a way to standardize the approach by which agents or AI models could access APIs. If you think of it, like an API will have a description of what it does, it'll have some different arguments, and then so programmers naturally would be the ones whose job would be to figure out how to call those APIs. So what MCP does is it puts it in a format that the AI agents would, who naturally know how to program because that's a part of sort of their training set, they're able to then more easily and efficiently like call upon a different system. So MCP is a great way to standardize the way that you integrate different systems together.
So if MCP servers a great standardized manner for agents to talk to each other, how come we keep hearing that there are security risks involved with MCP and they're not generally safe to use?
I think there are some very real concerns with MCP, especially if you don't use them appropriately, or people who build the MCP servers are not building them effectively. And I sort of categorize three big reasons why some MCP servers are not secure. So the first is that some of them are not what you call enterprise grade, just from the way that they're built and the way they're distributed. Also, some of them are give too many permissions. They are overly broad in terms of either access to data or access to tools. And then the third is that they expose new attack surfaces, things like prompt injection and other sort of data poisoning style of attacks.
So three very important categories of these risks. Break each one down for me, starting with the first, you know, MCP servers sometimes not being built in a very enterprise-grade manner.
So one of the things that's really awesome about MCP has been how quickly it's been adopted by basically the whole world. So you see there's a number of different small companies, a number of developers, a number of people in different organizations that are all building MCP servers to support integrations. And so naturally, somebody who wants to go use these, they'll want to take advantage of this new stuff that's created. But sometimes when they were created them quickly, or maybe they're early betas, or maybe they're not quite done yet, and they're kind of examples, they come with some sort of flaws, things that I'll call like not enterprise grade. And by that, I mean things like some of them had authentication challenges, like they either didn't authenticate at all, or they authenticated very poorly in a way that was vulnerable to attacks. Some of them were like when they built and hosted them, they didn't quite secure them the way that you should secure any type of enterprise class software to make sure that you can't it has to have vulnerabilities, a system it relies upon are secure, and that you can't just inject or to otherwise attack the system. And then also there's the challenge of just making sure that they're trusted. And so like some attackers would go out of their way to expose fake MCP servers who would actually go and steal your data in different ways by basically tricking you into running arbitrary code. And because MCP servers do boil down to sort of arbitrary code that was going to touch very sensitive data in many cases for enterprises, then all of these are major concerns.
So when we talk about MCP, and even in that previous episode where we, you know, gave sort of an overview of MCP, we talked about MCP being basically this toolbox, right, for agents to be able to access different things, have access to each other, and be able to complete, you know, more and more of a workflow.
Yeah.
How come there are all these risks associated with what is simply a toolbox?
These tools are inherently accessing some very critical things. Either they're able to change things that you would often consider very critical in terms of state of the world, or they're accessing data in different ways. Like at Box, we have an MCP server that accesses your unstructured data. Some of this is the most valuable data that people have. And so we need to make sure that when we're putting out and we're maintaining these MCP servers, that they're incredibly trusted. And so some of these MCP servers, depending on what it's going to access, will have the MCP server itself accesses very critical data and thus must have the highest level of enterprise-grade security.
So let's move on to now the second risk that you outlined, giving either overly broad access or instructions.
Yeah. So one of the key challenges with MCP, if you're not careful, is that you give it access to too much data or you give it access to too many tools. So for instance, let's say that that I'm going to be an agent. I'm going to offer you an agent. And it's going to do something straightforward. It's going to just look at your emails and then just notify you if something is urgent.
Sounds helpful. Yes, yeah. I would want to know that.
So in this example, like the AI agent needs to just see an incoming email and then does an assessment and then it has access to notify you, maybe send you a text message or something. Mm-hmm. Okay. So imagine if while you're setting that up, it says, is it okay if I access all of your historical emails? And maybe you didn't have a choice. It just automatically gave access to all of your.
Or just assumed access to all of this.
Or even worse, what if it also wanted access to all of your personal files? It wanted access to all of your calendar. It wanted access to everything. How would you feel about that?
I would feel really uncomfortable. Yeah. That's way too much freedom.
Yeah, and imagine that it also could change anything. It could not only email you or send you text messages, but it could also send it to anybody in the world. How would you feel about this?
Extremely uncomfortable. Yeah. Yeah, that's too much. Asking the agent to do too much.
And so this is an example of sharing either too much data or too many tools. And in both cases, there's this like natural feeling of discomfort, almost as if I said, hey, I have an application for you. And then you said, oh, that sounds great. And then I said, give me your whole computer and log into all of your data, and then I'll do that for you. And then this triggers this sense of unease, which is a very appropriate, especially when you're thinking about data security and an enterprise grade sort of challenges about what's going to happen with your agents.
Got it. Okay. So now, Ben, let's move on to that third and final risk.
So one of the challenges when you're using agents in general is that oftentimes they are looking at data from an external source. In the email example I gave, it was reading emails. Many agents will have like a chat interface with the outside world for things like support agents. Sales agents will have access to like input back and forth. Our box agents will have access to data that people share with them. And so in all these cases, you have to be worried about what comes in that data. And as we discussed in previous episodes, there's when an agent is looking at data, you have to worry about two things, which are
prompt injection and data poisoning.
Yes. And so in this case, like agentic data poisoning, about basically trying to set up data that the agent will go look for to be, which will poison its instruction set or its mindset, so it's able to do something that the attacker controls. And if you're not careful, then the agent or the MCP client will decide to do something that was not expected. In this particular case, it's actually not the MCP server that is being that's being insecure. It's actually the agent
itself.
In which case, but it's the more that agent has access to, the more that these problems of poisoning and of prompt injection and all related types of challenges are worse because now the agent can do more. So we've seen examples of this on the internet where somebody will put out an agent and then somebody will trick it into not only going using its tools to look up data, imagine customer data in a CRM system, imagine HR data in an HR system, imagine data that the agent would like query in databases and so on. And then it can take that and actually send it to the attacker. Or even worse, it can actually send the attacker its credentials, like a token or some other authorization. So then that person doesn't even have to have the agent like ferrying data back and forth. They'll just use that sort of compromised authentication to go access that data directly. And so this is all sort of a byproduct of not properly securing MCP servers when you use them in practice.
Wow. Okay. So now that we've kind of outlined these three risks, they sound really serious, especially in cases where we're looking to leverage MCP as a great way for agent-to-agent communication. What are some, mitigations or just considerations that enterprises can have in mind in order to prevent these risks?
So one of the key things is that, like, I think in all software and all sort of enterprise-grade mentality is to think about least privilege. If you're going to have an agent whose job is to look at new emails and then do something, then make sure that it's restricted down to only looking at those. And then what it can do is restricted as much as possible into doing the limited set of things. As we talked about before, don't give agents access to anything that they don't have, that you don't want them to do. In this case, don't expose the MCP server capabilities unless you want your MCP client to be able to do those things. And so this idea of least privilege, you'll want to use MCP servers that offer you the ability to cut down the scope of what the agent and what the MCP client can do, which would be a byproduct of whatever platform is accessing and whatever the controls that the person who created the MCP server is able to, what they exposed. Second is human in the loop. In this case, you'll want to have either the agents that you create or the ones that you use from a third party or the ones that are your MCP client to be able to recognize when it's going to do something that is dangerous and then prompt the user. So then, and this is a common technique of many of the like agentic coding systems and the ones that are emerging, is that before they do something that would be dangerous, they have the option to prompt you. And that's a very good option, human in the loop, so that it will say, I'm about to do this. And in this case, it'll help it so that it doesn't suffer as much from these kind of like doing something that would be dangerous. And then the third major thing is that just like any software, you should use trusted platforms and you should use trusted MCP servers. Get it from a trusted place. Make sure that it has you trust the person that you trust the organization that's providing it to make sure that it's properly secured, proper best practices, proper maintenance, proper vulnerability closing, and so on, so that you have the sense of when you're trusting your data, or in this case, an AI agent with tools to access that data, then you're trusting it to some organization or to some platform that you believe has the ability to make sure that's secure, not just now, but continuing to evolve the security over time.
So even though there might be some risks just on the surface level that seem like, okay, MCP servers may not actually be a good solution, there are some mitigations and considerations that enterprises can take into account in order to be able to use them in a secure and safe manner.
I'd say like the TLDR is just because it's new and interesting and powerful software doesn't mean it's not software that accesses your data. So you need to treat it accordingly so that you understand it and use it appropriately for your enterprise.
Very interesting. Thank you, Ben. And that wraps up this episode of AI Explainer Series. Make sure to hit that subscribe button so you don't miss another episode. We'll see you next time.